We are in the season of Advent, and during this time, we are preparing for Christmas. The whole goal of this time is to prepare, to celebrate God coming into the world for our salvation. But more specifically, we are in the third Sunday of Advent, and this Sunday is called Gaudete Sunday. Gaudete means rejoice, be filled with joy because of God. So as we prepare, part of our preparation should be to rejoice in God. We are to recognize that deep down joy that comes with our faith, that comes with knowing and loving Jesus Christ. One of the most beloved stories for this time of preparation is called The Christmas Carol, written by Charles Dickens. Now, even if you've never read that story, there is probably a pretty good chance that you have seen and watched some version of it at some time. It's a great story. It's a story about Ebenezer Scrooge. He's a greedy man who only thinks of himself. He doesn't seem to care about anyone's suffering at all. Even at Christmas, he doesn't care. But then, through some sort of internal experience with ghosts in the night, they show him Christmas past, Christmas present, and Christmas future. And through that internal adventure, there is a transformation, a total conversion. And when he wakes up, he is filled with joy. And this joy transforms him, making him into a generous person, a loving person, and a caring person. And he goes out into the world changed. Again, filled with joy. Speaking of joy, 2 weeks ago, I mentioned in my homily how our deepest desires can only be fulfilled in God, because our desires are infinite and only God is infinite. We may get temporary happiness through things, but it is only in God that we get that real deep down joy. To do this, we need to have that daily contact with God. Our second reading today confirms what I had said. St. Paul wrote in our second reading, "Have no anxiety at all." Okay, I like that line. But what gives us that confidence? What gives us that confidence that St. Paul wants us to have? And he continues, "But in everything, by prayer and petition, your thanksgiving, make all your requests known to God." St. Paul is saying that our prayers, our petitions, our thanksgiving, that will give us confidence, that will fill us with joy. So in the Christmas Carol, Scrooge has that internal experience with the supernatural, and upon waking, he is a different person. St. Paul is saying that when we pray, when we engage with God internally through prayer, we will also be changed. We will become a new person. 2 weeks ago, we began to explore the importance of daily prayer in the life of a Catholic. Every Christian, because we are Christian, because we are baptized, should spend time with Jesus every day, because we should spend time with the ones we love. That's what Catholics do. We pray. 2 weeks ago, we looked at the importance of memorized prayer, how to begin a prayer life. Last week, we looked at spontaneous prayer. This week, I would like to share another way to pray based on the readings from today, where Paul calls us to pray with petitions and thanksgiving in order to change us. I would like to take a moment to explain acts of prayer. You see, this is a word play so that you can remember how to do this prayer. We will do acts of prayer. The word acts is an acronym where each letter means something. A means adoration. C means contrition. T means thanksgiving. S means supplication. The goal of this prayer is simply to do each one of those things in order. You can use this prayer in a couple of different ways. First of all, you can do it very quickly and just do each thing just as a very quick thing in preparation to do some other prayer. So if you're going to pray the rosary, you may quickly go through the acts of prayer to get ready to pray the rosary. Or you can take a longer period with each one of these things and make it your entire period of prayer and give it some time. Here's how it works. Go to your place of prayer. Whether that's kneeling, whether it's that special prayer chair that you have in your house. When you're there, you begin with the sign of the cross. You may begin again with maybe some memorized prayers to get yourself focused on God so that you're ready. Take some time to recognize and just sit there for a moment and say, recognize how much God loves me. That's one of my favorite parts of prayer, is just recognizing that I'm being loved at this moment. Then you begin. Start with the letter A in the word acts. Adoration. Begin by focusing on God. Worship God. Adore God. Recognize God in all of his glory and majesty. Recognize that God is creator and we are his creation. But most of all, recognize who God is. God is love. One of the most important principles in Scripture is that you become what you worship. That's why Scripture was always saying that idolatry was the worst of the sin. You become what you worship. So if we actually worship and adore God is love, and then that's what we worship, that God is love, we will become loving. We will begin to love those who God loves. So you always begin with A in Acts, adoration. After a time of adoration, the next letter is C, contrition. The word contrition just means I'm sorry, to be contrite, to be sorry. We pray the act of contrition after we go to confession because we're saying sorry to God. During this time of prayer, what you do is you review your life, your activity, your recent past, and you ask, have I sinned today? Where have I worked against God? Where have I hurt other people? At this moment, we just look at those sins and ask God for forgiveness. This is also a wonderful time sort of to review and ask, is it time for me to go to the sacrament of reconciliation yet? But knowing our sin is important for two reasons in specific. One, we recognize that we need a Savior. We actually recognize, I need a Savior because I've been separated from God. I need a Savior to come into my life and to reunite me to God. Secondly, when we know we're forgiven, we recognize how much we are loved by God. God loves us that much. And there's that wonderful line of the woman who was forgiven, who was washing the feet of Jesus. She who was forgiven much was able to love much. Isn't that a wonderful thought? The more we're forgiven, the more we'll be able to forgive others and to love others. So that's second, contrition. Third, T, act. And so T is thanksgiving. As we look at our lives, we thank God. And did you ever notice the more thankful you are, the more joyful you are? God created us. God saves us. God loves us. Everything that we have, everything that we are, is gift from God. And if we can let that gratitude well up into our hearts, we can do nothing but be thankful to God. So at this moment, we just look at our lives and thank God for all the good that He has given us. What a wonderful moment to sit in thanksgiving. The last letter in Acts of Prayer is S. This means supplication. And supplication is just a fancy word for asking God for our own needs and the needs of those around us. We make supplication to God because we need help. This is the time where we will pray for those we love. We pray for our family. We pray for our friends. We pray for our co-workers. We may pray for those who are sick, those who are struggling in life. We may pray for the poor, for the world. Now, one of the most powerful elements of this prayer of supplication, it forces us to look at the world around us, to look at our lives and ask, who needs my prayers? In asking this, it creates an empathy within us, an empathy where we're constantly looking, who needs my help? Who needs my care? And not only does that mean we'll pray for them, that may mean we will actually reach out and help them. If we never think, who needs my help? We'll never know who needs my help. So this act of prayer helps to create an empathy and a caring within us. This is the part of prayer where we engage to save the world. I can remember very clearly when this type of prayer became important to me personally. You see, when a young man is ordained a priest, he makes a promise to pray what's called the Liturgy of the Hours every day. This prayer is basically praying the Psalms for some time in the morning, in the evening, and throughout the day. When I was in the seminary, I loved this prayer. We would all gather in the chapel and we would pray. And then once I was ordained, I prayed this for a number of years by myself as a priest. But then there came to be a point, after doing this for 16, 20 years, I began to think, I'm not getting a lot out of this anymore. I've been praying the same Psalms over and over again, and I began to think, I'm getting frustrated. So I went to an older priest, and I talked about my frustration with praying the Psalms. Now, this older priest, very wise, but he was kind of grumpy at the time. He looked at me and just said, stop thinking that way. You're not praying to get something out of it. You're the pastor. You're praying for your parish. Stop being so selfish. Get on your knees and save your people. That was the best piece of advice I was ever given in prayer. Now, every day, when it's time for my prayer, I think to myself, I have a purpose. I am going to go on my knees to save the world. I do this prayer every day for all of you here right now. I do it to save my parish. I have a sense of urgency to get down on my knees because it is there that I am going to pray to save the world. This is what supplication is all about. When you come to the end of Acts of Prayer, before you get up from your prayer, just try to make a small resolution. I'm going to work on some little thing to change my life. I'm going to avoid this particular sin. I'm going to do this act of kindness. I'm going to say this nice thing. I'm going to clean up this part of my language. I'm going to make a resolution. Just something simple that you can do that day. I would hope that as you hear these different ways of praying, that you'd experiment a little. Try them out. If you forget what I've said, because acts of prayer includes some steps, I'll put it online on our Facebook page so that you can look it up. This is a very simple way to pray, but very profound. It is when we encounter Jesus that we are actually transformed, that we are changed. When Scrooge woke up that morning, he ran to the window and yelled, "Boy, is that giant goose still in the butcher window? Here's some money, bring it to the Cratchits." And then Scrooge ran through the streets, being generous, filled with joy. If we can encounter God in a similar way in prayer, that could be us. We could be filled with that joy. So rejoice. Gaudete.